Welcome to Visual Studio Online Fundamentals. In this session, we're going to be talking about using source code with Team Foundation version control. It's quite a mouthful.
Yeah.
There's a lot of words there. Basically, what we'll be covering is, like the other sessions, choosing a Team Foundation version control, or Git. Mm-hmm. We're going to have that, and then dive into a demo. And we'll be walking through using Team Foundation version control with that. Now, as you choose between TFVC or Git, that's Team Foundation version control, or Git, you have a couple choices to make. And what, well, let me start at the beginning. Visual Studio Online supports two completely different version control systems. You can choose a centralized version control system, like Team Foundation version control, or you can choose a distributed version control like Git. So we have one of those. You're either going to go with Team Foundation version control or you'll go with Git. So there's pros and cons to both of them. Team Foundation version control has been part of Team Foundation server for ages. Been there since 2005, since the launch. Very mature. It integrates extraordinarily tightly with tools like Visual Studio and Eclipse, any Eclipse-based IDEs. It's a centralized version control, so it's one place where you have all of that single source of truth, and things get uploaded into that one single repository. That repository is then hosted on Visual Studio Online. Also, it is scalable to enormously large repositories. Many, many, many gigabytes of data with tens of thousands or millions of files can be supported in Team Foundation version control. Git, on the other hand, is a very popular distributed version control system. And for Git, you're looking for things like offline access and the ability to commit multiple times locally before we share our changes with the rest of the organization. Very easy branching and merging. And Git will work across the board on, I'd say, pretty much any IDE that's in common use today. Because it's such a common open source version control system, Xcode supports it, Eclipse supports it, Visual Studio supports it, and a whole slew of other IDEs, including very, very light ones that are just almost text editors. So you get a lot of support with that with Git. So you have to make that choice. Now, in this presentation, we're going to be focused on using Team Foundation version control. There's a lot of really wonderful, wonderful things that we can do there. But the best way to see it is through a demo. And James, I'm going to kick it over to you on a demo on how we can work with Team Foundation version control.
Perfect. Let's go ahead and jump in. Now, we're going to start with a project that already exists. It has some history in it. It's on Visual Studio Online, so we're just going to jump to the team project homepage, right? So here's our team project homepage, and all we have to do to get to the code is click the code area, which is pretty straightforward. And we jump over there, and we'll notice that it jumps right into our source code repository on the left-hand side. We have our project called My First Project. And then we have some other things, such as a branch. So this is our main branch, and it's denoted by this little branching glyph over here on the left-hand side. And we can see that there's a demo web app in there. The first thing here that we can see is that we can actually dive into the code from the web access itself. Rather than having to grab the code, download the code, and take a look at it, we can just jump into the web access, point to our folder structure, and just jump into whatever file we want to look at. So let's take a look at one of those files. So if I jump into demo web app and go to the controllers, there's one of the controllers, accountcontroller.cs. This is a C# folder, and you'll notice here that it has some syntax highlighting. Well, actually, it has syntax highlighting. So we have our using statements, some comments. If we scroll down, we'll see all the different things that are a part of this file itself, which is fantastic. Now, there's some other really cool features that are a part of just viewing this file too. One of them, which is a really cool one, called annotate. And there's a little button here that we can see that says, show annotation blocks for this file. And if we click that, what it brings up on the left-hand side is, where did this change come from? Essentially, where did this line of code right here come into play for this particular file. And you'll notice when I highlight that piece of code, it actually highlights the left-hand side here. And the left-hand side here is denoting the change set number, which is 34 over here. Who made that change set? Which is James Tupper, that's me, and the date that it was changed. And we'll notice here that if I hover above it, it actually brings in the comment for that change set too. Now, if we come down here and look at these two lines, we'll notice that these two were part of a different change set. So in line, where did this piece of code, this line specifically come from? Whether it be a change set or something else.
That's really handy. And I can see using that as a debugging mechanism. If I come in and you've made a couple bad changes in one thing, mm-hmm. I can look at this, find the change set, and find out maybe what other code went in that change set as well.
Yep.
Nice.
Cool. Now, there's some other things here too. One of them is compare. So we can actually compare files, different versions of a file in Team Foundation Version Control from the web. You don't need a tool or a client at all to do any sort of diffs between different file versions. So you'll notice here that this is just change set 34 versus change set 35, which is the latest as it says there on the web. And you'll notice that it does the diff side by side with a little cool scroll bar here on the left showing where on the page that change was made. And you'll see green denotes added code and red will denote removed code. Right?
Makes sense.
Yep, pretty easy. There's also a little button here that shows this is a side-by-side diff. If we click this, it will switch us to an inline diff. So if I go ahead and click that, it shows me, rather than having two different files side-by-side, just show me the file itself and show me the diff within the file without having two different sets of files.
That's very convenient. So I might use this if I happen to be just really quickly trying to understand some code. I can go out here, I can look at it, I can make a diff, I can really get a hold of it. I don't see this replacing Visual Studio or anything down at that level, but it makes it very, very convenient to have that right up here front and center as part of a feature of Visual Studio Online.
Yep, absolutely. Now let's go to one last thing. There's also this area called change sets. So if we jump to change sets here, you'll be able to see all of the changes in the entire project, right? And you'll notice that there's Source Explorer over here on the left-hand side. If I click that button, I can actually scope down to different contexts within my team project and get the history on that context, right? So I can click on main and it'll show me all of the change sets for main. Or if I click on build process templates, it will show me all the change sets for build process templates.
That's slick.
Yeah.
That's really neat.
Cool. So let's actually jump into an IDE and make a code change and see what that kind of workflow would look like from a developer's perspective.
Sounds good.
So I'm going to jump into Visual Studio here, and you'll notice that I'm connected to my first project, which was the project I was just working in. And it brings up a little yellow message in Visual Studio, essentially telling me I need to have a local workspace. So if you remember, this is a centralized version control system. So all of the code and all of the history resides on the server. All we need to do is map the server path to our local path, and bring those files down locally. So to do that, it gives you a little help here that says configure workspace. Click that button. It automatically puts it into a folder structure, the default projects or workspaces folder in your user profile folder, but you can change that here. I'm just gonna leave it as is and hit map and get. So that will map it and then do a get latest on my code.
Pulling it down basically from the server to that local workspace.
Mm-hmm.
Now I wanna just share a little bit if I could with people who might be just getting started with Visual Studio Online. This is one of the more common areas that people trip up a little bit. It's on that mapping of the workspaces. It's very important that you just kind of realize centralized version control system, Visual Studio Online has all of that code and the changes, and you need to pull it down to a particular folder locally. That's your representation of what's there. And then you interact by saying, hey, has anyone made any changes on the server? And when you've made changes, you interact by pushing those changes up to the server itself by checking in your code.
Thanks, Steve.
My pleasure.
So now that we've got the workspace mapped and we've got the code locally, it'll actually open up and show us what solutions we have in those folders so we can just quickly open one up and make a change to it, right?
Sounds good.
So we have Team Explorer here, and here's our solution. And you'll see that it's in the main folder, and it's in the demo web app folder. So if I just double-click that, it opens it for me. And you'll see that it turns bold. That means the file or the solution has now been opened, and now we can start working on it, right? So before I even get into that, I'm going to jump to a little area called My Work, just to show you where does my work come from Visual Studio. And this is a great way to see that. If we click that, it'll show me what are the work items that are assigned to me and ready to kind of work on, right? So if we look here, there's available work items called ones 254 dev task, right? Pretty generic, but you could think of it as unit testing or adding some functionality, something like that. The greatest part about this is that we could just drag and drop this into in progress, right? Currently, this is a to-do task. Drag and drop right to in progress, and you'll notice that it kind of focuses our attention. It says, hey, this is what I'm going to start working on. Before I even do any coding, this is what I'm going to work on.
And I think this is really interesting because that dev task resides in VSO. This is not something that's just here in Visual Studio. This is a VSO project. This is a work item, and we're linking this together, that change set, with that work item.
Yep, absolutely.
Back to you.
Cool. So now let's jump to our code and actually make a change to it, right? So let's jump into controllers and open up one of the controller files. And I'm just going to come in here and make another comment. This is the constructor. This is the account controller constructor. Just like that. Go ahead and save it. And if we pop back to Team Explorer, we'll notice what happens. It actually picks up that edit and it starts doing the association to that task right there, right as soon as we start coding. It's not an afterthought where we link up our changes to a work item after we're done with them. It's forward thinking. I'm focused on this particular dev task. I'm making changes for this particular dev task, right? And once we're done, there's a little button here that says check in. So if we jump over there and we hit check in, we'll notice that that work item, the dev task, is in the related work items. We can make a comment. And you'll also notice one thing here is that that is resolved. So the default behavior here is I work on a task, I make changes for that task, I go to check it in, and it resolves that task, right? Pretty easy workflow. So let's make a change saying add comment to the account controller file, like that, and hit check it. And you'll notice there's a dialogue here. The first one is check in confirmation. Continue to check in one item and resolve slash associate one work item, right? These can get annoying, so if you want to, you can hit don't prompt again and just hit yes. And there it goes, it checks in our file for us.
And then that then is pushed now up to Visual Studio Online?
Yeah, so now our code's in Visual Studio Online, right? And if we go to Visual Studio Online, and jump over here, and we'll have to go back to the Explorer so that we can see stuff. Go to the history of our file, and we'll notice that my change set that I just checked in, add comment to account controller file, is there. And if I click that to get more information on it, it shows me again, I made the check-in, when I made the check-in, how many associated work items are there, and it actually shows the associated work item right there in my change set, as well as doing the diff, right? So you can see that here's the inline diff again of what was added or what was changed on which files as part of that change set.
That's pretty cool.
It's pretty sweet.
This is pretty amazing stuff. Now, I want to come back then and challenge you. I'm a new user.
Yep.
I've just signed up for Visual Studio Online, and I'm understanding that, yeah, I need some place to put my code and to protect it that's off of my machine. Mm-hmm. Or maybe I have a team and we want to move to Visual Studio Online. Help me get there. What are the few steps I need to take as a new user to get some of my existing code up into Visual Studio Online so I can start work today?
Absolutely. So when we first create an account in Visual Studio Online, it will take us to this landing page. If I click this, it takes us to this landing page right here. And what you'll need to do is you'll need to create a new team project. And to do so, there's a link right here under recent projects and teams. And if you click that, it will bring up a little dialogue that allows you to walk through creating a new team project. So give it a project name, call it my TFVC project. Right? give it a description if you want to, choose the process template, and then the last piece, which is the most important piece here, is choose which version control system that you want to use for this team project. Team Foundation version control is already selected, so I'm going to leave that as it is and click Create Project. And that will go and create a brand new team project that we can connect to via IDEs or the web access or other tools out there.
Gotta say, I love that spot. I know I probably mentioned it before, but your project is created and your team is going to absolutely love this.
Absolutely love it.
I agree.
And it gives us a link to navigate to the project. So this will navigate us to the project via the web access, but that doesn't really help us. We haven't gotten code there yet. So how do we do that? Let's jump back to an IDE. We're going to jump back into Visual Studio here. I'm going to close out of my context. And you'll notice here in Team Explorer, right at the top, there's a little plugin. And if you hover above it, it says Connect to Team Project. So what we're going to want to do is click that button. It brings us to this Connect page. And what we're going to want to do is select Team Projects. It's the next link. Click Select Team Projects. And you'll notice that my TFVC project is now here. It's been created, it's now something I can connect to. So I'm gonna select that, checkbox it, and then hit connect. We're now connected to it, and if we go to the home page, we'll get the same dialogue we saw earlier, where it says you need to configure a workspace because you haven't mapped a local directory to the server yet so that you can get code there. So let's go ahead and do that, and click map and get. And again, I'm just gonna leave the defaults here as my TFVC project in the workspaces folder and click map and get. We've now mapped everything. There wasn't anything in that folder, so we didn't get anything. But what we wanna do is just go ahead and open up Source Control Explorer. And you'll notice here that our project is now mapped locally. So when I select my project on the left, you'll see that there's a local path to where it was mapped to. So how do we get code that we have pushed into our project? We just click this link, opens up Windows Explorer, and I have my other code on another Windows Explorer. And I'm just gonna select all, copy, go back to this one, and paste it in. And just like that, it'll copy and paste it into the folder.
You got yourself a lot of code there.
Yeah, lots of files. Perfect. It's now in. And we can go back to our Team Explorer and hit the Pending Changes window. Now you'll notice something here is that there's no actual included changes, but there is a link that says there's a bunch of ads that were detected. So if we click that button and just hit Promote, it should have everything selected by default. Hit Promote, it will promote all of our code into included changes. And now all we have to do is go to the comment and say, adding initial code, and check it in. And that's all you have to do. And now all of your code is pushed into Visual Studio Online. It is now located in Visual Studio Online. You can share it with your team members, you can collaborate on it, and now you can version your code using Team Foundation version control.
Yeah, I've got to say, if you don't have your source code somewhere off your local machine, you've got a problem. You're wrong. You need to have that somewhere else. This is a brilliant way to take your code, get it up somewhere where you can work on it, and it's at least safe. And better yet, if you're working collaboratively with someone, if James and I are working together, or your whole team is working together, now you've got it uploaded online, shared, where we can all work on it, even if we're geographically distributed. That's a really powerful thing. James, that was a wonderful demo.
Thanks.
I appreciate that. And I want to urge those folks out there that are watching, go out, grab a Visual Studio Online account, create that team project, very, very easy to do.
Very simple.
And get your code moved over and uploaded into Visual Studio Online. Thanks again, James.
Thanks, Steve.